Hello, everyone, and welcome to The Vortex, where lies and falsehoods are trapped and exposed. I'm Michael Voris. When you look up a definition for the word crisis, you encounter two main thoughts. First, a time of intense difficulty, trouble, danger, or instability. Second, a time when a difficult or important decision must be made. For example, a crisis point of history, to use it in a sentence. When many good people look around the church today, they see a crisis. That crisis manifests itself in a large number of ways. Liturgical abuses, heretical priests and bishops, a Catholic faithful that really isn't all that faithful. On that point, this week, the latest poll exploring the issue of Catholics who practice contraception revealed that between 97 and 98% reject church teaching. As many brilliant and saintly minds have expressed for centuries, when you reject one teaching, it's very likely you reject others as well. So it's not surprising that most Catholics also do not go to Mass, 75% in fact. They do not receive our Eucharistic Lord, a fact which seems to check out when you consider that less than 30% believe in the real presence. We've covered these issues very extensively in other Vortex episodes, trying to lay out the why and the how of the crisis in the church. But there is one issue we have not spent a lot of time discussing, and that is why and how the crisis continues, essentially unabated to this very hour. The reason is that too many good Catholics simply do not want to see the crisis. This fact has created a crisis within the crisis. Now, certainly, when one looks at the depth and breadth of the crisis in the church, it is breathtaking. It's horrible and ugly to see. The church has gone through other crisis periods before and always emerged stronger, but never without first accepting this simple fact that we are in a crisis. Often, when church leaders finally got around to facing the facts, much damage had already been done. For example, Martin Luther was dismissed by Rome as a drunk German. Luther had not been the first to foment a great revolt from inside the church, but when he launched his revolt, something new had come into being, the printing press. All previous revolts had been largely localized because of the inability of them to spread far and wide owing to difficult travel conditions. Whenever a rebellion sprang up somewhere, the laity in other parts of the church were by and large unaffected. There are, of course, some exceptions, but at least directly. But sociological and technological advances changed all that. Now revolution could be exported easily, and it was. Luther rocked the church with his heresy, and the church has never really fully recovered. It was a crisis, and when a choice had to be made, when the crisis moment arrived and a choice had to be made, church leaders whiffed. Christianity has never been the same since. The church lost a third of Europe because of people not facing the crisis moment. Moving ahead to today, it's a fair statement to make that the extent of this current crisis is far greater than even the Protestant revolt. Back then, it was a third of the church that was severed. Today, it is a far, far greater percentage. Two things are very different about today's crisis compared to Luther's revolt, and one thing is eerily similar. The two different things are this: the degree of heresy and its acceptance within the church today. It's a soft heresy, a quiet, almost indifferent dismissal of sacred teachings of the church, and a refusal on the part of many of those in charge to take any real substantive action to kill the heresy. Unlike Luther and John Calvin and the rest of the original band of heretics, there are no real firebrands, no fire-breathing detractors of the faith. Today, they simply give speeches at conferences and write articles and appear on TV interviews and are polite and all buttoned down. The second difference between today's crisis and Luther's is this: the speed at which the revolt spreads. With the simple press of a button, one heretical or heterodox idea after another is foisted on the faithful in articles and emails. The use of the media by the enemies of the church has been simply masterful, and that goes for enemies inside as well as outside the church, especially those enemies within. Luther got kicked out and took his show on the road. These new Luthers hang out and kill from within. The damage that Luther did with the printing press looks laughable compared to the nuclear war that has been launched against the church today. Despite the differences between the Protestant crisis of the 16th century and the modernist crisis of the 20th and now 21st century, there is one major scary similarity, and that is the unwillingness to face the fact of the crisis. Some people are understandably afraid and paralyzed with fear, so they don't want to admit it. Others simply can't see it because they have personal dispositions, personalities that cannot process conflict. They avoid it like the plague, oftentimes unconsciously. They simply cannot stomach the idea of the hand-to-hand combat that is required when a crisis hits. The crisis of the 16th century took about 50 years for the church to really face, and then another 50 years to begin seriously mounting a counter-revolution against. That counter-revolution was possible in large part because small pockets of faithful men and women recognized the crisis and decided to seize the moment by forming new religious orders, preaching boldly to defend the faith, committing themselves entirely to the defense of Holy Mother Church. These men and women saw exactly what was going on and took action, often in the face of massive ridicule and mockery. They were able to correctly perceive the crisis and make the choice to march headlong into the fray, and through their efforts, many returned to the church. The refusal by so many today to acknowledge the current crisis has become its own crisis within a crisis. We so need the 21st century version of the 16th century saints. God love you. I'm Michael Voris.
Please help us keep delivering these kinds of messages that so desperately need to be heard and acted on. Join RealCatholicTV.com today as a premium subscriber. Become immersed in the faith established by Jesus Christ. The Catholic Church is the only hope against evil because that is its God-given mission. As our Lord said, apart from me, you can do nothing. Join RealCatholicTV.com today as a premium subscriber and come to learn and love Christ more deeply.